Macmillan Audio presents Hitler's American Friends, The Third Reich's Supporters in the United States by Bradley W. Hart. Read for you by Chris Andrew Ciulla. Introduction. On the evening of September 11, 1941, one of America's most famous men took to a stage in Des Moines, Iowa, to discuss the national security issue that was on everyone's mind. Exactly six decades later, the date of Lindbergh's speech would be associated with a far different type of threat. But on this night, the famed aviator, the first man to fly solo across the Atlantic Ocean, Time magazine's first man of the year, and once estimated to be the most photographed man in the world, was discussing the war in Europe. The United States was not yet involved in the conflict, and if Lindbergh and his fellow members of the America First Committee had their way, it never would be. Lucky Lindy had been traveling the country for months arguing against American intervention in the war, making the case that the country's geographic separation from Europe and Asia and its two bordering oceans were sufficient protection from foreign attack. The United States should prepare for defense, not offense, Lindbergh and his associates believed, and if the country could establish a ring of air and naval bases around its perimeter, it would become an impenetrable fortress. Providing aid to Britain, the last Western European country still fighting the Germans, would simply detract from building up the country's defenses. This was the standard isolationist position before Pearl Harbor. Let the Europeans fight their own conflicts and make sure America was sufficiently prepared to stay out of them. This fateful Iowa evening, however, Lindbergh deviated from the standard script. Perhaps he was full of confidence from becoming the America First Committee's most popular circuit speaker, receiving so many invitations to towns and cities across the country that there was simply no way he could accept all of them. No doubt he was partially inspired by the Roosevelt administration's recently passed Lend-Lease policy, which had made it through Congress earlier in the year, and allowed the president to provide military vehicles, aircraft, and munitions to the ailing allies. Whatever the exact alignment of reasons and circumstances, Lindbergh chose that night to unveil his own interpretation of American foreign policy. The consequences would haunt him for the rest of his life. In past speeches, Lindbergh had referred broadly to unnamed, powerful elements that were seeking to draw the United States into the war. But he left the details up to the listener's imagination. Tonight, before a crowd of more than 7,000, he decided to reveal exactly whom he believed was behind the alleged push to war. There were, he told the crowd, three groups that had conspired to draw the country into the conflict: the British, the Jewish, and the Roosevelt administration. Together, he continued, these groups had executed a plan to draw the country into war gradually by building up its military, and then manufacturing a series of incidents to force us into the actual conflict. Britain, he continued, might be able to hold out against the German onslaught. Yet even if it did, there was no hope of invading Europe and liberating France. Under normal circumstances, the British government would have made peace with the Germans long ago, but was merely holding out to make the United States responsible for the war financially as well as militarily. President Franklin D. Roosevelt was simply playing into the hands of the perfidious British. The bulk of Lindbergh's ire, however, was reserved for the second group he mentioned, the Jews. It was understandable that Jewish Americans sought war against Germany, he claimed, because the persecution they suffered in Germany would be sufficient to make bitter enemies of any race. However, the Jewish groups in this country should realize that in the event of war, they will be among the first to feel its consequences. Jews themselves, he concluded, presented a unique danger to the country because of their large ownership and influence in our motion pictures, our press, our radio, and our government. Despite the alleged machinations of these groups, Lindbergh reserved hope that they might cease their efforts to push the United States toward war. If that could be managed, he continued, I believe there will be little danger of our involvement. Lindbergh's speech was covered by major papers and carried on page 2 of the New York Times the following morning. It quickly sparked a firestorm. Was Lindbergh blaming Jews for the outbreak of the war in Europe? Was he claiming that Jews were in control of the Roosevelt administration? These seemed very much like the same claims being made by Adolf Hitler and his fellow Nazis in Berlin. The comparison did not go overlooked. White House Press Secretary Stephen Early remarked that there was a striking similarity between Lindbergh's speech and recent outpourings from Berlin. New York City Mayor Fiorello LaGuardia was less sparing in his condemnation, calling the remarks a carbon copy of a Nazi paper. Jewish groups denounced the slurs and called on Lindbergh to retract the comments, similarly evoking comparisons to the anti-Semitism of the Nazis. The outrage spanned the mainstream political spectrum. Roosevelt's past and future Republican rivals for the presidency both denounced the remarks. His 1940 opponent, Wendell Willkie, proclaimed himself shocked by Lindbergh's bigotry. If the American people permit race prejudice to arrive at this critical moment, they little deserve to preserve democracy, Willkie remarked. Roosevelt's future opponent in 1944, Thomas Dewey, similarly told a Republican Party picnic that Lindbergh had committed an inexcusable abuse of the right to freedom of speech. When the religion or race of any individual or group is made a part of the discussion of domestic or foreign policy, that is a challenge to our freedoms, he continued. Faced with growing pressure from all corners, the America First Committee's leaders, who had not reviewed Lindbergh's speech prior to delivery, were forced to put out a statement asserting that the organization was not anti-Semitic and blaming the interventionists, those who sought to take the United States into the war, or at a minimum, provide additional aid to the Allies, for inserting the race issue into the discussion of war or peace. The attacks on Lindbergh, they claimed, were simply a distraction from bigger issues. This half-hearted explanation did little to calm the controversy, with the New York Times noting in an editorial that the committee had not actually disowned Lindbergh's sentiments about Jewish Americans, and by not disowning them, it associates itself with them. What is being attacked is the tolerance and brotherhood without which our liberties will not survive. What is being exposed to derision and contempt is Americanism itself. Behind the scenes, however, the committee was seeing a grassroots outpouring of support that very much contradicted the stories being seen by readers of the Times. In the committee's mailroom, at least 85% of the letters being received were supportive of Lindbergh, in part because of the anti-Semitic undertones of his speech. Some messages were so extreme in their racist language that the committee did not see fit to even respond, but others came from regional leaders of their own organization and other paid-up members. Lindbergh was clearly far from being the only America First member to harbor such views about who was really responsible for the war. The emerging controversy between the respectable voices within the America First Committee's leadership, who saw the need to denounce Lindbergh, and the rank-and-file membership, was symptomatic of the wider divisions in the United States before Pearl Harbor. Lindbergh was just one of a wide range of figures who argued positions ranging from isolationism to the establishment of closer relations with Nazi Germany, and, in the most extreme cases, the adoption of Nazi policies in the United States. These groups and individuals often did not get along with one another. It was supposedly forbidden for a member of the German-American Bund, the nation's largest and most prominent Nazi-emulating mass organization, to join the America First Committee, or so the America Firsters claimed. Yet these organizations were working toward many of the same goals, whether they were aware of it or not. The America First Committee's goal was arguing to keep the United States from entering the war in Europe, an objective perfectly in line with the intentions of the German government, and in fact, the Bund itself. The German embassy in Washington, D.C., for its part, instructed one of its agents to support and promote America First, because it was the best thing you can do for our cause. Whether they intended to do so or not, or even aware of it, the leaders of America First had become an important asset to Hitler's government. The German government was far from wrong in its belief that the United States might be potentially kept out of the war in Europe. There were even some indicators that Americans, however unlikely it might seem, might even be receptive to National Socialism itself. In June 1938, Gallup polled Americans on their views of the respective merits of fascism and communism, asking them which you think is worse. While nearly half of respondents offered no answer, 32% thought communism was the worse ideology. Only 23% saw fascism as more destructive. 7 months later, Gallup asked Americans, if you had to choose between fascism and communism, which would you choose? Around half again offered no answer. But among those who did, fascism and communism tied at 26% each. Though this result was a major decline from March 1937, when a full 45% of respondents who had recently read about politics willingly chose fascism as their answer, with just 29% responding with communism, a level of comfort with the concept of fascism endured. The United States was not at risk of an imminent fascist takeover in the late 1930s, but there was certainly fertile terrain in which dictatorship might be able to take root. More important was American public opinion related to the war itself. Intervention versus isolationism was the most potent political issue from late 1939 until Pearl Harbor, dividing friends and families against one another in a way that would not again be seen until the Vietnam War era. The isolationists, led by Lindbergh and some of the country's leading congressmen, argued that America had no business getting involved in the war. Any form of intervention, they argued, would inevitably result in young men dying on faraway battlefields and financial ruin at home. President Roosevelt and his administration led the interventionist side, arguing that Americans could not afford to sit the war out, lest the Germans and Japanese become unstoppably powerful and a direct threat to the United States. This became more than an academic argument when France fell to the Nazis in the summer of 1940, and Britain was left to face the Nazi onslaught alone, with London being bombed nightly, and the British Expeditionary Force barely making it out of Dunkirk. There was no guarantee that Britain would not become the next Nazi-occupied country. If Britain were to fall, would America be next? No one knew. In August 1940, Gallup asked Americans if they thought Hitler would invade the United States if Britain fell under Nazi jackboots. Opinion was evenly split, with 42% believing the Nazis would invade the United States and 45% disagreeing. Public opinion was equally split on what the United States should actually do under these circumstances. In 1940, the British ambassador to the United States, Lord Lothian, told a friend in London that American public opinion was 95% against Hitler and 95% against being drawn into the war. But as the fear complex dies away, thinking Americans are beginning at last to ask themselves seriously about their own future if the Allies don't win the war. This assessment was not far off the mark. A year before Pearl Harbor, 79% of Americans said they wanted their country to send supplies and equipment to Britain, but only 11% wanted the U.S. military to actually help defend the country. Most Americans believed sending aid would be beneficial to their own interests. In January 1941, 57% of respondents told Gallup sending aid to the British would help keep the United States out of the war. U.S. is still extremely friendly to the Allies and vehemently against both Hitler and Stalin, but they will not abandon neutrality until their own vital interests are affected in some obvious way, Lothian presciently wrote in January 1940. Favorable polling numbers were certainly good news for the British, but London was also aware that maintaining favorable American public opinion was a delicate task. In February 1941, a Fortune magazine survey reported that a full 33% of respondents believed the most prominent advocates of sending aid to Britain were propagandists, not patriotic Americans. A plurality of 48% disagreed and thought they were patriots. The skepticism toward Britain, evident in findings such as this, meant the country's spokespeople had to be very careful not to push their case too hard, lest their American advocates lose credibility. Accordingly, The British Foreign Office issued a general...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.